Mushrooms, a delicious topping and ingredient in many foods that we all know and love, with a wide range of species all giving different flavors, textures, and visions. So-called magic mushrooms are species of mushrooms that have psychedelic properties and result in an altered state of consciousness when consumed. But how did these mushrooms become magic? To answer this question, we must first investigate what makes a mushroom magic. Secondary metabolites are organic compounds produced by living things. One such secondary metabolite is L-tryptophan. It is an alpha amino acid found in many places, such as cheese, bananas, and even you and I. However, in hallucinogenic mushrooms, it undertakes a special pathway where four enzymes, Psi-D, Psi-K, Psi-M, and Psi-H, create a combined reaction to synthesize psilocybin. Psilocybin is the chemical that gives hallucinogenic mushrooms their magic properties. When psilocybin is consumed by humans, it is dephosphorylated within the intestine and liver by alkaline phosphatase to become psilocin, which when paired with psilocybin can cause hallucinations. Hallucinations are a result as these chemicals are classified as serotonin receptor agonists, specifically to the serotonin receptor 5-HT2A, which when activated is the primary cause for psychedelic hallucinations, which is exactly what happens when these chemicals are ingested due to the fact they are agonists, enabling them to activate the 5-HT2A receptor. Now that we know what makes these mushrooms magic, it begs the question, how did they become magic? In all living organisms, there are two ways to gain genetic material: vertical gene transfer and horizontal gene transfer. Vertical gene transfer is between a parent and their offspring, whether that be sexually or asexually. It's the mechanism that gives us all the basis of our genetic makeup, and hence why we all bear some similarity to our parents, as do plants. This is how evolutionary mutations that have been made are passed from generation to generation, thus how the first mushroom became hallucinogenic, or magic. An ancestor long ago developed a mutation that resulted in the hallucinogenic properties and was passed on from generation to generation. But before I said there were many species of mushrooms, did all the mushrooms with the psilocybin mutation just occur by chance? As it's not like the mushrooms bred with each other, right? Well, this is where the second form of genetic transfer comes in, horizontal gene transfer, the transferal of genetic information from one organism to another. In 2017, Hannah Reynolds and five other researchers examined the genetic makeup of six mushrooms, three of which were known to produce psilocybin, and three of which were not known to. To examine the genetic makeup, the DNA of each of the six mushrooms was sequenced and compared to each other. The six sequenced genomes resulted in 16,294 orthologous groups of proteins, genes that evolved from a common ancestral being. Out of these, only five were clustered within all the psilocybin-producing mushrooms and were involved in psilocybin production, all five of which predicted functions were consistent with the psilocybin biosynthesis and metabolite transport, those being Psi-D, Psi-M, Psi-H, Psi-K, and Psi-T. The orthologs of these groups shed 75 to 95% similarity between all the psilocybin-producing mushrooms, and upon phylogenetic analysis, support horizontal gene cluster transfer between the three psilocybin-producing mushrooms. However, they were unable to deduce which mushroom originally developed the mutation with 100% certainty. This finding was a first for mushroom-forming fungi, thus providing new insight into evolutionary mechanics and ecological diversity of fungi. But why did these mushrooms share and promote the gene for psilocybin? While bioactive molecules similar to psilocybin are often assumed to have niche-specific roles for their ecological context, the research found that distantly related wood decay and dung decay fungi had less difference in their genome when compared to more closely related fungi in other niches. This implies that while the fungi were distantly related, ecological pressures were similar, and the uptake and promotion of the psilocybin gene cluster was a survival strategy implemented to influence the activity of common threats such as arthropods. But how is this relevant to you and I? The research conducted by Reynolds and her companions has provided a methodological roadmap for future endeavours regarding the discovery of more novel fungal pharmaceuticals. The fungi in these niches could be further sources for neuroactive chemicals, thus advancing the prospecting and synthetic biology of novel neuropharmaceuticals, which in the case of psilocybin is showing great promise for treatment of depression, anxiety, addiction, and even migraines. But that's a story for another day.